Welcome to part three.
You realize without a past, you can't have a future. You have nothing to project. So we're questioning our stories of the past. And as we come to see that what we thought happened didn't, what's left to project as a future? Other than, there's a word for it, heaven. There are other terms, like a wonderful life. So this visiting the past and questioning, you know, it's your future you're dealing with as you think you're working with the past. So who has a legitimate need left other than the one in the moment? Who worked on a need that they're still holding? Good.
I need God to take the responsibility.
So you need that. Is it true? Can you absolutely know that it's true, that that's what you need?
My answer to this was, I don't know.
So turn it around.
I don't need God to take the responsibility.
Okay, so where did that smile come from?
I don't know. I don't know.
Can you find another turnaround?
I need God to be irresponsible.
You're going to get along really well in this world.
That's funny for me, and it's maybe I just sit with it. And
to me, John, it's a thought that maybe you've been dealing with all your life. Like, to you, maybe God does seem irresponsible. So it's kind of a getting in touch with that, the way you actually see God. That's totally irresponsible. God is so irresponsible, I think I'll take over from here. In fact, I think I'll even dictate God's life. God, I need you to this, I need you to that, I don't need you to this, don't do that, do this. Can you find another turnaround?
I need me to take responsibility.
Yeah. So live it out and see how far you get with it. What is it that you want him to take responsibility for?
For everything.
So turned around, I need myself to take responsibility for everything. So live that out and see how far you get. See, I take responsibility for everything because everything comes out of me. Just as everything comes out of you. Everything. Everything. The way you see everything comes out of you. The way you experience everything comes out of you.
May I share something?
I don't know yet.
My concept is that God should have all the glory, and that that I should just be an instrument or an expression of that. So,
what if you are and you drop the should? What if you are a part of God's glory? And that you shouldn't drop the, what was it you said? What was it? that you can drop the should of I should be his instrument, and you just are. But you know, sweetheart, as long as you think you're a you, it's really dear to give all the glory to, you know.
I really think I am a you. So, I interrupted you. Would you say more?
I don't know. If I were going to give, if I thought there was me and God and I was going to give one of us the glory, I would give it to God. I would definitely give it to God.
I like that. And yet he still left me to make a decision or to do things. So it's like everything is set up for reality being that he's...
Sweetheart, listen, you know, rather than us figuring this out...
Yes.
You know, what I can say is eventually, you don't know the difference. You're so connected, you don't know the difference what's you and what's God. So it's just, it's so merged that if there's anything at all, there's just no separation in it. And that all the decisions you need to make, you begin to notice they make themselves. So I would keep it very, very simple. Just very simple. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Who else has a need that's left? Yes.
I need me to create my own prosperous future so I can keep coming to Byron Katie seminars.
Can you absolutely know that that's true?
No.
Turn it around.
I don't need me to create my own prosperous future.
So that I can?
So that I can
come to so that I can come to Byron Katie seminars. Yeah. For all you know, if you don't make money, you can come anyway. Who knows? Who knows? Money could come from somewhere else. Money could come from a lot of places. You know, just out of the blue. All I know is when I need it, it's there, and when I don't need it, it's not there. You need more money, is that true? Okay. So let's
sometimes.
Work with it. This seems to be running rampant here. So when I ask, is there a need left, I see the need. Okay, so who would like to work with the money thing? Who believes it? Okay, so stand up. So I can only deal in the moment because that's where we're at. Would you all agree with that? I mean, this is where we are now. Okay, you need more money right now in this moment. Is that true? In this moment. In this moment, you need more money. You need more money in this moment. Just in this moment, you need more money just to sit here right now and be you. Is it true? And how do you react when you think the thought you need more money? You project a future. And the pictures start coming of you with a shopping cart that has old clothes in it rather than groceries from Whole Foods. How do you react when you think the thought, I need more money? A future comes and it's you in poverty. And it's you in the job that you're not in now. And it's you failing, succeeding, frustrated, frightened. How do you react when you think that thought? The world of poverty is born right there. That's where it's born. poverty mentality. So, sweetheart, how do you react when you think the thought, I need more money?
Panic. Yeah. Right here in the chest, it's hard to breathe.
And who would you be without the thought, I need more money? If you could never have that thought again.
Free to enjoy my life right now.
Which is where you are.
Yeah.
Two ways to be where you are right now. One was it is in a mental, like a poverty mind, or just the experience of knowing, seeing, clearly realizing that you have everything you need right now. Don't you right now? Well, right now is where you always are. Right now is where you're always going to be. There's no other place you can be. It's not possible. So they're taking your house. Close your eyes. They're taking your house. They're taking your house away because you can't make the payment. Because you owe somewhere else, money somewhere else. You're being sued. Your house is going. All right, close your eyes. Put yourself in that position. All right, notice. Get the picture of them taking your house. Now notice where you are in the moment. Are you sitting? Are you standing out on the street? Where are you? Notice as they're taking your house. Are your children crying? Is your partner angry? Notice where you are right now. They're taking your house. Now notice where you are just in that moment. Wherever you are as they take your house, you need more money just in that moment. Is it true? Just in that moment, from wherever you're standing, wherever you're sitting, you need more money. Is that true? Just in that moment. And you might even look at, in that moment, you need a house. Is it true? You know, these questions are meditation. So, sweetheart, what did you find? Who would you be without the thought, I need more money?
What I found was I was sitting on a suitcase outside my home, and that in that moment, I was given the strength that I was needed. In that moment, I was told what to do in that moment. And so, yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. I just thanked me. I need more money. Turn it around.
I don't need more money.
Not in this moment. And what grace to know that's all you ever have to deal with. And if you want fear and terror on purpose, get a future. You're like little Daniel last night. It's like, was he angry at his father or the father in his head? The picture of the father in his head or his father. It wasn't his father he was angry with. This is what we're, this unquestioned mind, this mind we're believing in the moment. Try this one. No one has ever needed more money than they have in this moment. And you also realize that no one can have more money than they have in the moment? It's not possible. No one can ever have more or less money than they have in the moment right now. Good to know, huh? Yes.
I just have a question about that related to poverty, because I do a lot of work with people, especially that are immersed in trying to eliminate poverty. So then if you have a family where, say, the parents don't have the money they need to get the food to feed their children, and their children are going to school and they're hungry and this sort of cycle, I can't get my mind around how they don't need more money.
Because you're into problem solving.
Right. And yeah. So I'd like to...
And see, you work with them around poverty, and I just worked with people around poverty, true poverty. If you take them into the moment, You know, if I take you into your son needs food right now in this moment, is that true? You know, turned around, my son doesn't need food. Turned around, I need food. Okay, yes. So if I believe that, let me go get the food. And one of the things I like to do with food is give it to my children. It begins with me. But I need more money. I need food. How do I react when I think that thought? Look, fear, hopelessness, depression, alcoholism.
So it kind of starts with that moment of I need and I don't have, and then that affects...
The child that believes what they think. And that would be the adult you're working with.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, and if you're the child, work with you first. And as you work with them, do your own work. Okay, so let's have some fun. Okay, so turn to the I resent page in your notebooks. So I call this the I resent list. So I invite you just to let your mind to run freely. You can start from your first memory of someone and go all the way up to now. Or you can start from here and go back in time. Or you can just randomly wait for someone to come to your mind and then find the resentment that you hold against them. You might start with the person you love most in the world and wait until you see the resentment there. But where it can really flow is, you might try going back to your earliest memory, coming all the way up, looking at what you resent, the people you resent. Any questions? Yes. If you don't resent anyone, okay, just close your eyes and think of someone and wait until a resentment comes or some kind of a little rub. And if it doesn't, just enjoy the silence. Okay. Yeah. And also, you may, even if it's just a tiny little rub, you may use that. It could really open you up. And also, some of us, if you don't have resentment, pretend as though you do. Even, you know, just that slightest rub and write it down as though it were. Okay, so, yes. Yeah, don't use yourself. Okay, let's begin. We're going to be doing direct work with ourselves in these 2 days. So for now, just follow the curriculum, and thank you for the question.
How many of them?
Yeah. So let's just begin. How many of you need more time with this? Would you raise your hands? Okay. How many of you need more time with this? Okay. Yes, so read until someone yells uncle.
I resent Danny because he was born and took my attention. I resent Terry because she's helpless and believes she's stuck. I resent George because he's in a nursing home. I resent Larry because he tells me what to do, controls things, is crappy and doesn't listen. I resent Annie because she tries to fix me. I resent Judy because she's successful in business. I resent Zan because she tells Jay what to do. I resent Jack because he didn't tell me what to do. I resent Jason because he lives at home with me and lets me take care of him. I resent Mrs. Vickers because she ridiculed me. I resent Ori because he didn't fix me. I resent lawyers because they sue. I resent doctors because they make a lot of money. I resent college grads because I'm not one. I resent my dad because he died. I resent my mom because I'm afraid I'm like her. I resent my aunts because they judge me and expect me to take care of my mother. I resent Will because I don't see him. I resent Jay because he seems so nice and still lost his business. And I stop there.
Wow. Did she say one thing you don't relate to? Was she reading your list? Yeah, so your partner that you sit with, in case you missed one, maybe they hold it for you. So now I invite you to turn to another partner, someone you don't know, someone you haven't worked with yet. If you don't have one, in a moment, I'll ask you to stand up, point to someone, and pair up very quickly, and read your list. Your partner will read their list to you. Just listen. Just listen. The silent listener, just connecting with that person. And then at the end, say thank you and switch. And then as you read yours to your partner, just read it straight through. And when you're complete, both of you close your eyes and just sit in the experience. Any questions? For right now, we're only going to read to each other. So let's begin. Person, and just run a list on them. Anytime you're upset with anything or anyone, put your mind on paper. Run the list. Several people, one person, as many resentments as come to mind. Now the next step is, who would read their list out loud? Thank you.
I resent Shirley because she made herself more important than her children and admits it.
Okay. So if I were to work with this one, how would I do it? I would get rid of I resent because. Now read it, Shirley.
Shirley made herself more important than her children.
You circle that. Shirley made herself more important than her children. We believe, mind believes what it thinks, and it has all the proof, you know that. It annihilates them with the proof, and it annihilates you for attacking them. And so you attack, it attacks you the way it attacks them, same tactics. Now you have two annihilated people, and you wonder why you're confused and feel bad. So Shirley, again, Shirley?
Shirley made herself more important than her children.
Is that true? Can you absolutely know that that's true? That Shirley made herself more important to her than her children.
No, I can't know that.
How do you react when you think that thought? Shirley made herself more important than her children.
I'm angry with her. I feel really uptight inside. And I want to make her not important.
Who would you be without this thought?
A friend.
So turn it around.
Shirley didn't make herself more important than her children. I made myself, well, let's see. I made her more important than me.
Can you find other turnarounds? Just simple reversals.
I made myself more important than her.
So you're doing with her what you think she does to her children. I am... See if you can hear this. In the moment I judge you as doing something, I am doing that very thing in the moment I judge it. Shirley is making herself more important than her children, and right now I am making me more important than Shirley. And there's no escape from that. Because mind is projected. It's a projection. No, let me say that differently. Life is a projection of mind. So what I think is mirrored in how I see the world. Mind is the projector, and life, surely, is the projected. So how could I see her that way if it weren't coming out of this? If it's coming out of this, then where's original cause? Right here. And what's the effect of that? Surely, and she's certainly beneath me, I'm up here, she's down there, I'm God, I know. I have condemned myself to hell in the moment. And confusion is the only hell. And I saw another turnaround. Would you like to hear it? I have made Shirley's children more important than her. So as you sit in these and you begin to look at it, you know, just experience and... Okay, thank you, sweetheart. So you see how this works? Who has a list that they would read? Yes, in the back.
I resent my mother because she left me with a stranger.
Because she?
Left me with a stranger.
My mother left me with a stranger. That would be what you circle to give your facilitator. And if you're at home, that would be, those would be the words you use to self-facilitate. My mother left me with a stranger. Okay? And work with these three turnarounds also. Shirley put herself... Okay, my mother left me with a stranger. So turn it around. Let's say you've gone through all of the questions.
I'm not sure how to turn it around.
Okay. Yeah, it's an interesting one. Here's where my mind went. My mother left me with a stranger. My mother did not leave me with a stranger. Now I'm going to find three ways that that person was not a stranger to me. So, how old were you?
I was 5.
Okay. And did you know the difference between genders?
No.
You didn't know what was a male and what was a female?
Well, I was the only child in the family. So.
Did you have a father?
Yes.
So you knew your mother was a woman and
yes.
Your father was a male.
Okay.
Okay. So you knew the difference between genders.
Okay.
Okay. So was the person, the stranger that she left you with, a male or a female?
Male.
Okay. So she left you with a stranger. Is that true?
Yes.
Okay, you knew he was a male. You knew something about him. What else did you know about him?
Nothing.
Nothing? Nothing at all. Okay, so just wait just a few moments and see if you can just find anything that was familiar about him. Were he any place that was known, like hands were not...
He lived in the same apartment complex.
There. Lived in the same apartment complex. Had you ever seen him before in that apartment complex?
Just the day before.
Good. So he was a stranger. Your mother left you with a stranger. Is that true? As the world would see it, yes, it's true. Not someone you had been with, not someone you were familiar with, but the mind is a child. It believes what it thinks. And I'm pushing on this one because for me, I really have to know. There's no one I can meet. Because when you finish this, there's no one you can meet ever, ever again in your life that looks like a stranger to you. You know who we fear? We fear people after our mind projects who they are. And of course, they're strangers to us. We believe what we think about them. Like you're walking down the street... And there's a man coming, walking toward you, and he looks shaky. He is not looking like someone you want to be on the same side of the street with. Because your mind is saying all this stuff, and you think, oh my God, oh my gosh, you know, oh my gosh, you know, it's very frightening. Then he gets close, and he reaches down and picks something up and says, did you drop this? You know, all of a sudden, that man is not who you think he is. And all the fear is gone. So was the man you were frightened of, or your thoughts about the man you were frightened of? And it's always that way. Once you get to know someone, you feel safe. So that's why I'm pushing on this. He's a stranger. My mother left me with a stranger. Is that true? No. I saw him the day before. He lived in our apartment complex, and it was a he. He was a man. Did he smile at you? Did he, the day before?
Yeah, he tried to teach me to swim in the pool, but he wound up being my abuser.
Yes, but up to that point,
yeah,
he tried to teach you to swim in the pool.
Right.
So he is a stranger. Your mom left you with a stranger. Is that true?
No.
Very good. You've come a great distance. You see the I know mind, how stuck it is? You know a lot about this man. And that opens up a whole territory. You know, it's you're about to take a very exciting path. And it takes an open mind, and I wish you well on it. Okay. And I'm just talking like the next 10 minutes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Boy, my mom left me with a stranger. How do you react when you think that thought? Look how you've lived your life when you think that thought. Yes.
Same. I mean, what we're talking about too is how bigotry and racism and all these thoughts we get, we're taught or we think we're taught, and we hold on to these things, and so people have an automatic distrust or fear. And
honey, you got it. That's it. We do a 9-day school, and we have capsules that are just devoted just to this, just to prejudice, and it runs so deep in us. Yeah.
Would you help me with this one? I resent the male God because I feel it's disrespectful to women.
So I would write it out like a male God is disrespectful to women.
Okay.
You know, or whatever it is that... And keep reading your list. Read some more of your list.
I resent my mother and father because they couldn't protect me and my siblings from childhood predators. I resent my sister Mary because if I get upset, she tries to fix me and give me advice and vitamins. or tinctures or homeopathics. I resent my sister-in-law Marilyn because she takes from my mother-in-law's estate whenever she visits.
Okay, so there's one to circle. She takes from my mother-in-law's estate when she visits.
Right.
So now thank you, honey. Now I invite you to go through and circle the ones, the portions that would make it very simple for your facilitator to deal with and that are also very meaningful to you. Circle the three that you find the most potent for you that your facilitator can deal with. Yes.
A question. I'm not sure how to deal with this with the turnarounds. I resent Paul because he sexually abused me.
Okay. So the turnarounds, after you've questioned it, are going to take a lot of courage.
Oh, thanks.
And, you might end up thanking yourself. And I experienced that, and physical abuse, molestation, and penetration, and all of that also when I was a child, and in fact, several times. And it was horrifying, and I wouldn't ask you to do anything I wouldn't ask you to travel anywhere that I haven't traveled. And what I can tell you is on the other side, no matter how your mind opens, on the other side, it's going to be okay. Yeah. That turnaround, he abused me, turned around, I abused me. And then to find three ways that I abused me, and I start in that situation.
So you just take the sexually out?
Oh, no.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, right. Right. It's quite a trip. It's quite a trip. It's quite a trip. It's the trip for an open mind.
that only the open mind can take this path. And some of you, you're not quite as open-minded. It's like you're still, I know, I'm not going there. And then just breathe and know that that's okay too. And just breathe and know that that's okay too. Okay, just be very gentle with yourself and take the trip and know that it's going to be okay. Yeah. What's not okay is living the way we've been living and all of that, that pain and suffering. Okay, so circle the three that that your facilitator can give back to you simply, and that are deep and meaningful for you. Just circle the portions, the one-liners. Okay, now turn to the blue sheet in your notebook, the facilitation guide. Now look at this, you'll see the four questions and turn around. And look at the sub-questions. There are a lot of them. Some of them will be appropriate to use as a facilitator. And if you used all of them, your client's going to feel like they're being interrogated. This is not necessary. Some of them will be appropriate and meaningful depending on the concept you're working on, and some of them just won't work. And sometimes they'll all work, and you don't need to use them all. But as a facilitator, this is where you begin to get your own fingerprint. It's where you begin to experience a little flexibility with these four questions and turnaround. And when you get to the turnaround, see if you can. Laura, do you have one? Lana, do you have one to work with? Like a one liner? Which did you circle? Three of them.
Okay. Uh-huh. My father doesn't hear me when I say no.
Okay. Your father doesn't hear you when you say no. Now, when we get to the turnarounds, so turn it around.
My father hears me when I say no.
Okay. Now give me three proofs of that. So again, meditation, you go in, you find the times when you talk to your father and he did listen.
I just found it.
You found it. Good. And if you found one, you can find two. That's why I asked for three. If you found three, you can find a whole lifetime. It's opening the mind into the polarity that has not been open to it. You know these positive affirmations that people use, that work until you get the parking ticket? When we go into these three ways, they have to be genuine. Because this is not a play. You cannot be fooled. You know, this is the end of denial. Three places where your father, when did listen to you. Now, can you find another turnaround?
I don't listen to my father when he says no.
Now, go into your life and give your facilitator three times that your father said no and you did it anyway. That's when I got pregnant. How about you? So three times that when my father said no, I didn't listen. Okay? And then the next turnaround. So these finding three ways, you know, it's meditation. You go, and where have you sexually abused you? and you look in that situation, see if you can find it in the situation. It's not about blame. It's not about shifting blame. It's not about anything except it's the truth that sets us free. Because until I recognize it, I'm going to live that same thing again, because that past I haven't taken care of projects the future that I see. That's how we create our own reality. It's like, if I get physically ill, I didn't make me sick. You know, I didn't give me the flu. You know, in one way I did. Let's say I got on the plane. I bought the plane ticket to get here. I get on the plane. I get the flu bug and I get the flu. Well, yeah, in one way I did. I got on the plane. I'm responsible for that. I had no way of knowing, but I'm responsible for it. It begins with me, okay? But I didn't do it on purpose, and I didn't know people had the flu, okay? So, but here's the other polarity. They did it to me. They did it to me. So I can never find solution to it. Okay, so where did I sexually abuse me in the moment? And here's what I found. There was this old man that he was doing some work in a rental, and I was a little girl. I was like 4 years old, three, four, or five, like that. I can't nail it down. But he was doing some work on this rental, and I walked over there one day, and he put his hands in some very interesting places. And I can, as I tell it, I can experience his breath had alcohol on it. And it was really awful to that little girl that I was. It was not just alcohol. It was awful. And I knew something was off. But he was focused on me. And to my mind, I wasn't getting that with my parents. And I didn't rationalize that. All I knew was his whole focus was on me. So I left, and the next day, I went back. And the next day, I went back again. And then it really hurt. And he took me into this dark room, into the bathroom, actually. And I still don't know what happened in there, if anything, but I know that there was a lot of pain happening. And I didn't go back. I didn't go back. Okay, so when this came back to me at 43 years old, because it was gone until then, it came back to me at 43 years old, and I did this work I'm asking you to do. He sexually molested me, turned around, I sexually molested me. The man didn't chase me. I just kept going back in my innocence. But boy, when I looked at that, I just had to look at it. Where did I sexually molest me? Well, I kept going back. And what I saw as I sit in the silence with it is that I'll do anything for love. Anything. And that's what my next book is about. It's finished. I just got the Bound Galleys, but it's all about this. What we do for love, approval, and appreciation. If I had a prayer, it would be this. God, spare me from the desire to seek love, approval, or appreciation. Amen. What I did for love. But until I went back and I looked at my life the way that you're doing here, I had to continue to crawl on my belly like a love me, love me, love me, love me. And I don't care what you do, just love me. You want my money? Here. You want my house? Here. You want, just love me, love me, love me. Living like a slave. And we're going to work with this tomorrow too. We're going to crunch in a lot. But all I can tell you is open mind, be gentle. And when you get to these turnarounds, you know, close your eyes. And if you can't find ways, that's okay. You know, just be gentle with yourselves and see what opens up for you. Yes.
Mm-hmm. What do you do with something that appears to be a fact, such as, I resent God because the tsunami killed thousands of people? How do you deal with that?
So the tsunami killed thousands of people. So is it God or the tsunamis? The tsunami.
Well, if God's everything, then it's
okay,
the tsunami.
Okay, so God killed thousands of people.
Right.
Is it true?
It seems to be.
God killed thousands of people. Mm-hmm. Can you absolutely know that it's true, that God killed thousands of people?
No.
And where did the no come from?
Because God, if God's everything, I cannot believe that he would do this, he or she or it would do this deliberately.
Where did you go with it? With the no. God are people too? That's good. Is it possible to die? You take a corpse that has been underground forever and you put it under a microscope, it's moving. You know? And the you know, what you put in the toilet comes out as fertilizer. Everything is recycled. Water, air, I am that. And that, and that, and that. So, you know, God kills. So where do you go as you sit in the silence with this? God kills thousands of people. How do you react when you think the thought, God kills thousands of people? So you see, your answers are your answers. That's what I love about this work. Your facilitator asks questions, does not give advice, does not answer for you, and just trust that you find your way, and it's time for you to find your own way. You know, my mother said, it's a tree. Okay. It's a sky. Okay, do you believe everything? Do you believe everything you hear? Do you believe everything you think? Do you believe everything they think? Well, these 2 days, you know, this is about you asking you, finally. Yeah. And let's turn that around. God kills thousands of people. Turn around.
God doesn't kill thousands of people.
So give me 3 ways that that's true.
Well, we're all sitting here. Okay. That's a start.
Yeah.
And we have millions of people in this country and on the surface of the earth.
And some of us found that those people didn't die, they just changed forms. Okay. And they're busy feeding fish. Mm-hmm. And fish are busy feeding another fish, and on. So God kills thousands of people. Can you find another turnaround?
I kill thousands of people in my mind when I think about it.
As though a tsunami weren't enough. You know, the tsunami here goes on and on and on and on. You know, who is killing the most people, God or you, in your mind?
Oh, me, easily.
Yeah, good work. Okay, so find these 3 ways. It's meditation time. Sit with it. Let the answers, you know, open the mind and the heart. Well, you know, it allows the answers to come straight out of the heart, and then it hits it again, and the mind opens again. Okay, so what I can tell you is the work is like this. It's like the mind over here. It goes, something terrible's going to happen, something terrible's going to, he did it to me, she did it to me, they did it to me, you know, they don't love me, they don't. Over here, the mind. It has all the proof. And then over here, there's a mind that just doesn't bother dealing with insanity because it's too wise for that. So it just sits here in its wisdom, in its serenity, just waiting for a welcome. So now in the center, we have these 4 questions and turnaround, and it connects the polarities of mind. The I know mind and the don't need to be bothered with any of it. It's like the don't know mind will say. Okay, so in the middle, this one says, today, like something terrible is going to happen, something terrible is going to happen, and then the question, is it true? And this one waits. If it just waits long enough, then this mind penetrates. You see, polarities of mind. Polarities of mind. There's a left, a right, an up, a down, or, you know, we have right, a wrong, we have heaven and hell, we have opposites. That's duality. So as this one waits long enough, then its very own self, because everything is mind, its very own self will penetrate. And then this one's educated. Until finally, there's a merging. And the full mind is just balance in its own wisdom. It's found a home in itself. You understand? Okay, just words, but it's kind of like that. So the questions ask, allow this one just to be open enough for mind to penetrate your own mind, the mind of the heart. Okay, so we'll sit with the last partner you had in a moment. And if you don't have a partner, stand and very quickly point and very quickly partner up. And this time, use the blue sheet. And again, not all of those sub-questions. And you do one. You facilitate one, and then you switch roles. And then your partner will be the facilitator and facilitate you. You'll be the client. And then switch roles again. Okay? Any questions about this coming exercise? Does everyone have circled what you're going to work with? So you do one, your partner does one. You do one, your partner does one. Okay? So let's begin. Yes.
Well, we got stuck because we both had the same problem.
Both had the same father, of course.
No, problem.
Oh, both
problem.
Had the same problem. Of course.
And then we got busy talking about our situation because both of our husbands passed away this last year.
Uh-huh.
And then we got talking about different things, and then we couldn't get back to the three ways.
Uh-huh.
But we talked about a lot of other things.
Well, good. It sounds like life the way we've always known it to be.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. So where you got stuck in your story.
We got stuck in our story.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm sure it's helpful, too.
Yes.
Yeah. It's the old way, and it can be very helpful. Thank you. Where did the rest of you get stuck, if you did, in fact? Yes, honey. What did you find?
Well, is it true? Do you absolutely know it's true? Well, yeah.
Good.
And then...
And what's the one-liner?
The one-liner.
He molested me. What was it?
Paul sexually abused me.
Paul sexually abused me. So is it true?
Yes.
Can you absolutely know that it's true?
Yes.
That's very, very... We'll go back to that one in a minute. How do you react when you think that thought?
It is what it is.
And how do you react when you think the thought, Paul molested me? Like in your lifetime, how have you reacted when you think that thought?
Well, I've had some really good EMDR, so it's pretty stripped. But, I mean, previously to that,
yeah.
It was pretty awful.
Okay, so go into the description when you're doing the work. You sit with it as meditation. So let's just cut to the turnarounds. Turn it around.
What was it?
Paul sexually molested me.
Paul
sexually abused me.
Paul sexually abused me. Paul did not sexually abuse me. And that was the one where we got stuck.
Okay, so that one didn't work for you. See, I can find a way right now. Paul didn't sexually abuse me. For example, right now in this moment, he's not sexually abusing me.
Oh. Okay.
That's an open mind. And how many times did he sexually abuse you?
Weekly, for years.
For years?
Yes.
And were there intervals in between where he did not?
I think there was an interval when he had most of his stomach cut out because of an ulcer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, like he would molest you and then there'd be a space and then he'd molest you again.
It was pretty regular, but it...
But he did take time out to eat or sleep.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And every once in a while he took a day or two off.
Okay.
And especially weekends.
So that's where Paul didn't sexually molest you.
Okay.
You see, if if I'm turning it around, I'm going to sit with it. It may take me a day. It may take me 2 hours. It may take me a while.
This is quicker. I'd have sat a while. I mean, we did sit a while. Thank you.
You're welcome. What was another turnaround?
I sexually abused me.
And you found those?
Yeah, you know, numerous affairs and stuff.
Good work.
Bad sex.
Yeah. And how did you sexually abuse you with Paul?
I couldn't get that one.
How old were you?
It started when I was about 18 months.
18 months, uh-huh. And then to how old?
Early adolescence.
Like what age? 12, 13?
Yeah.
Okay. So, so why didn't you leave?
Because I...
So let me talk to the little girl. Okay.
Yeah.
Little girl.
Yes.
Little girl. Little 10-year-old girl.
Yes.
Have you ever had the thought of leaving, just running away?
Not after I had told people and told the priest and been tortured about telling people. And no, I didn't.
Yeah.
I didn't have the capacity.
Yeah.
To form those thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So he molested me, turned around. I molested me. You found ways. Good. Now, there's another turnaround. He molested me, turned around. I molested him.
Right.
He sexually abused me. I sexually abused him. Did you find three ways there? Very heavy stuff. Very heavy stuff. Very cleansing stuff. Very mind-blowing stuff. Because whatever I find there, until I find it, I'm still using it with my husband and other people until I find it, until I realize for myself, it just keeps happening. It's only when we realize it that it's like I don't stop, it's like it stops as I continue to realize myself.
Okay.
You're amazing. You know, I'm always amazed that people just don't get up and walk out of the room. Thank you, Precious.
Thank you.
What a journey, this journey within, huh? Yes.
I'm probably opening myself up here, but... Aren't you letting him off the hook when you say, well, there was a time when he didn't abuse me? I mean, obviously, there'd have to be time.
Well, this is about my work. This is
not
about
fixing
him. Well,
this is my work, too, you know?
Yeah. Well, I'm talking about my responses.
Okay.
It's like nothing is going to condone unkind actions.
Okay.
Nothing's going to condone that. And it happened. And we still hurt. So there's got to be an answer. And that answer has to be within me because I didn't find it in the world. Mm. And I was right. I found it. Where am I the perpetrator? Where do I continue to hurt me? And where do I continue to hurt other people?
Okay.
And I go back there and I look and I uncover it. And until I do, I'm still doing it. But when I uncover it, I notice it stops. Self-realization. Did you hear me talk about the snake and the rope?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like I'm the snake that I fear. And until I can see the snake's a rope, I can't be a rope. Yes.
I came up with something over lunch, and it came up again. And it is... an analogy to, harmony we're talking about, and it's an analogy to music being that, I don't particularly like rap music, but maybe somebody else does, obviously, so I'll let them enjoy it. And I'm talking in terms of, let's say, a relationship I'm with somebody, and they act in a way I don't enjoy, but They're getting something out of it. So do I treat it the same way? Like, cool, I'm glad you like that music. It's not what, I don't particularly like your music, but you seem to be getting something out of it. So it's to me it feels like a form of disassociation, but I don't feel bad about it. But I don't know that it's adding anything to it.
Working for you, then I say good.
It reminds me of that cartoon of the dog and the master. And the dog hears the master saying, blah, 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 blah. That's kind of how I feel like the person going, blah, 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 blah. So, I mean, in a way, I see it as sort of comedic, but I don't know that it's adding anything to... You know what? Do you know what I mean? I don't know that it's adding love to the world. But
well, you know...
Certainly not adding more stress.
You know, just connecting with what you said, it's like if I see someone enjoying rap music, and let's say I don't like it, which I do, but let's say someone's enjoying rap music and I don't, then I watch their face, I watch their body, and I am so happy for them. And so that's love. I mean, I am really happy for them. You know, drop your story and watch them dance and move and take it in. They'll drive up beside you in a car that's just boom, 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 boom. You know,
I can watch them. It's more in terms of a relationship where somebody is defensive, and so I can't. You know, essentially. I can't enter into it, but I mean, in terms of rap music, I really don't care one way or the other about it.
What was an example you used? But I'm truly happy, and it's the same with someone talking. Like, someone's telling me their story. They love their story, and I love that they love it. Who am I to take it from them with, is it true? They love their story.
So just let them go.
Well, as though I had a choice. But I will let you have your story. They have it already.
Yeah.
Yeah, good. Yeah. No, it's like it's that next step of just, you know, someone can come up to you, I'm so tired. I'm just, my goodness, you know, they're loving their story. That's their identity. You know, I think they're really into this. They haven't asked me for help, so I listen, just the way you're all learning to do here. I listen. Where do I do that? You know, some of us may go, oh, me too. You know, where do I do that right now? Or am I just listening, you know, and just appreciating that they are in the identity they need to be in? Can't remember the way this story went, but I was in a parking lot waiting for Stephen and one of my sons and maybe my daughter, but one of these big vehicles drove up and they started saying some, you know, the rap music was going in the car was, and they drove up beside me and they started saying some fascinating things. And anyway, we had an incredible discussion. You know, it was something like, you know, I don't recall. It's like, get in the car. Yo, get in the car. And you know, and I go, no, thank you. And all I could see was they really wanted me to join them. I thought, now these guys are... You know, these are the good guys. I mean, after all, don't they have great taste? They see they're having fun. I love to have fun. You know, it's kind of like that. I say, no, thank you. And thank you. You know, I see that you'd really like me in there with you. And I understand that. I'm really good company. But we talked like that, and you're crazy. And I said, you know, I've been told that before.
You know, I mean, we just had the best. By the time Stephen and the kids got out there, we were just really friends. Friends. We're going to work with some of this tomorrow. Okay. Love. Love is the power. And if I'm not into my story that's being projected from a past, then I only see friends. But if I haven't questioned my past, then I don't have the privilege of knowing how loving and caring the human race really is. No one would ever hurt another human being if they were not confused.
I noticed that I'm upset because, whatever, I don't need a mic. But it happened first with you. When you were saying about, you know, was he a stranger, you know, I started getting pissed off.
Yeah.
At you, technically. And then... and I know intellectually, well, I love you, I'm here, you know?
Yeah.
But what, and then I noticed it with you, too. It's like you can't let people off the hook. It just pisses me off. And I get how I want to stay mad, and it's wrecking my life, you know? And I want to leave, you know, because it occurs to me that it's easier to look at your pain. You know, but I know that it must be affecting me because I'm shaking all over, and I never even wrote a worksheet on it, you know?
Yeah. So, sweetheart, thank you. Thank you. Now, let's ask her, how's she doing? Ask if she was offended. Ask if she wants to be let off the hook. Ask, is she okay?
Are you okay?
I'm fine.
Now, that's a shocker. Is there anything else you want to ask her?
No. No, I noticed that she's fine. Look at her.
Yeah. So who in the room is not fine?
Me.
That would be you. Yeah. And so you do, with your thoughts, what she's done with hers, and she's the master. This is not easy, this work she's doing. She can do it, you can do it.
If I may, I've turned it around to bless him and realized the gifts. It took a while. I mean, I didn't do it when I was 10, but I realized the gifts, the experience has given me.
Yes.
Because there are very few people that are as compassionate as I am.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. There are very few people as compassionate as you are so far.
Yeah.
But through you, you know, we're catching up. Because, you know, you go before us. And thank you for that. So you, how you doing? Ask her if she's okay. So ask this lady, hold the mic again, and there she is. You know, she may not be. Ask her if she's okay. If she was okay with...
Yeah, were you okay?
No, not at first. I wasn't. Because until I heard more... I thought the same thing, that she's letting this individual off the hook. But it's not about his process, it's about my process. And it's about the years of living as a victim because of that one situation. And it didn't hit me until she said to this other person, were there times in between? Well, I only had one incident. So there were plenty of times when I wasn't sexually abused. But I really appreciate, because last night, that's what I was getting to. I could not hear your empathy or compassion last night.
Yeah.
Now I recognize the greatness of the empathy and compassion out of being responsible for your process. So yeah, I'm better for it.
Yeah, and the only way you could really recognize that is what you discovered yourself.
Right, the last 10-minute journey.
In yeah. So, and thank you for that last 10-minute journey.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And thank you for your empathy and compassion.
Okay, here's one for you to work with.
If I don't suffer, it means I don't care. How you doing? No. Again? What did he say?
The Pope actually had an article, not maybe a reporter reported about the Pope stating that it was important for all of us to suffer because it made us all better. And I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. Well, I can follow that.
Yeah.
You know, through your suffering, look what it has brought you to. And as you come to it, so the Pope could be right. He may just, maybe yeah. has missed a few little loops here and there.
Well.
Who knows?
Yeah.
And maybe not. Maybe, you know, just catching up. I can't know the Pope. Can I know myself? That's enough for me to deal with. I am my own freedom. I am the way. You know, you cannot be the way for me. This is the way, ultimately, the way inside of you. So as this mind opens up to its very own self over here, its very own wisdom, this one begins to be educated by this one, and then you just are left with the wise mind, the open heart. Yes.
Katie, how might you respond about somebody truly being in a dangerous situation?
I don't know one. If I thought I was in a if I were in a dangerous situation and I saw it, I would run.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Myself, how do I expect her to get along with me?
Mwah. Honey, I think you found it. Yeah. Brilliant. Yes. In the back?
I need help making a distinction about being in other people's business. Can I ask you about that?
Yes. I'm sure you can.
Okay, so...
You know, I just can't know the future.
So I see this work and... I want to make the distinction between staying out of someone's business, yet I just want to help somebody. I find myself around people who they're suffering, they have problems, and for some reason they're drawn to me. And I don't want to tell them what to do, yet out of empathy, I want to help them. So I'm interested in your distinction.
Well, so ask me for help.
I need help.
Good. I'd love to help you. How can I help?
Well, it all started when I was 3.
Oh, you know, I'm a very good listener. Tell me.
Great. I was in nursery school, and I fell, and I hurt my neck. And the next thing I remember is somebody carrying me off and throwing me in a car and whisking me away.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome. So where is it you need help?
You're asking me this?
Uh-huh. I hear that you fell on the playground and someone put you in a car and whisked you away. How can I help you? You asked me for help. How can I help you?
Actually, I don't need help there.
Thank you.
But you're just showing me that if someone comes to me and asks for help, then that's the time to offer it.
I didn't hear a problem. What I heard was they fell, they got in a car, they were put in a car, and were whisked away. Where's the problem?
There isn't one.
Right. So how can I... What am I helping here?
My original question was, if I want to help someone, yet I don't want to be in their business...
Okay, so give me an example. We tried that one. Give me another one.
Okay.
Like I was totally out of their business, but I was 100% available.
Okay.
You know, if you asked me, like, what do you think about that? I'd say I love being whisked away in a car. And for me, I used to dislike falling, and now I love it.
Okay. Another example. I'll go home, and perhaps a housemate of mine is going to complain about something in their life.
So tell me, you be her, let's dialogue it. You be her, and even exaggerate it. Give your best shot, and I'll be someone who cares about her very much.
Okay, so you want me to be that person?
I'll be someone that's compassionate, someone, what was your term? Someone that
empathetic.
Cares.
Empathetic.
Empathize, okay. Hi, I'm home.
Ah, shit, I got to get up and I got to work tomorrow, and it's going to be really busy, and I wish I had $1 million. I wouldn't have to do this.
Yeah, I hear you wish you didn't have to do this. Thank you for sharing that with me. I really hear you. That must be very hard, doing something that you don't want to do. Is there any way I could help?
Could you make me a millionaire?
You know, I'll sit with that. I haven't been able to make me one yet, but I will consider it. Who knows? Maybe it'd be easier for me to make you one than me one. I'm open to it.
Thank you. I get it.
Okay. You know, you can really get this. You're sitting with people hearing their innermost effects in life coming out, and you're being still, except for the questions you're asking. And the power in that, watching people find their own way. Oh, this lady here, you had your guess.
I wonder if you'd be willing to talk a little bit about your process. I know you said last night that it's been 20 years since you've had a problem or seen a problem. And, you know, I know I heard about, you know, laying on the floor, a roach crawls across your foot and you woke up.
Well, I don't say I woke up.
Okay, well, that's what, how would you say it?
I would say I woke up to reality. I woke up, I know the difference. I learned the difference between what's real and what's imagined. It's simple. We all know. That's what these questions are about. So I'm not special. All of us can wake up to what's the difference between reality and my thoughts about reality.
And it was a sudden thing for you? It was just, it happened? And
I just noticed that when I believe my thoughts, I suffer, but when I question my thoughts, I don't suffer. And I've come to see that that's true for every human being. No magic.
Wow. Thanks.
Yeah. You're welcome.